Well, I hope the morning's going okay for everybody. I am really excited to bring out our next guest, which is my good friend and longtime OpenStack supporter, Brian Stevens, who's now CTO over at Google Cloud. Come on out, Brian.
Hi, everybody.
All right, get comfortable. Is this comfortable for you?
Yeah,
I brought a couple friends.
They're in the balconies as well.
So Brian, you were involved in OpenStack from the very early days. You helped us launch the foundation. You were on the board. You spent 13 years at Red Hat, and then you left us. What the heck, man? You went to Google? What's that all about?
Yeah. Well, it takes me a while to chart my path. I think about OpenStack, I missed it for a year, 18 months.
No one
remembers that. It felt like a long
kind
of time. And then, well, because everything's about for me is like building communities and the evolution where things are going. And so it took a little bit to see that the future was OpenStack. But then, you know, I just sort of, even at Red Hat, I spent a lot of time thinking about like operational complexity. And when you look inside of enterprise and what does that look like? And if you ever really spend time inside of enterprise and not just being a vendor, it's a really hard job. And they spend a lot of time doing, you know, the labors of love again and again and again. And I think what you were showing earlier around, you know, automating infrastructure is a part to alleviate that. And I just felt public cloud is another tool, mm-hmm. right, to really help alleviate and really turn things into programmable infrastructure. And so to have an opportunity to be part of that, to make that real, I had to pick up the family and move to California.
Wow. So after being on the other side and telling people, it's not a big deal, just get the software and operate it, and you're like, well, I've got to actually operate it now. That's on the other side. It's not so easy, huh?
No, there's some new challenges that I never quite thought about. So I'm learning every day. I mean, the part about the vendor was awesome, where you give them software, and now you actually have to run it.
Yeah.
And it's like a goal. You only hear about your misses. Right, and so the dealing with reliability, and then I think the hardest part, to be honest, is that it's constant change, right? So you're constantly changing the platform, right? Because you have to, mm-hmm. but you got to keep the whole ecosystem and users alive and compatible along the way. And so just sort of the dimension of sort of what that looks like has been fascinating.
So one thing I'm sure at least one person in here is wondering is, does Google actually care about open source? You know, you've been in open source most of your career, and yeah. Now you're at Google, and I know they're doing stuff, but you know what's happening on the inside? Give us the scoop.
Yeah, I think we had a saying. This is one of the things you probably shouldn't say on stage.
Perfect.
Yeah, I think we said, what was the word?
Don't write this down, y'all.
Google is the place where great open source developers go to. We said die, but I think we really meant it's never to be heard from again. And we know that's not true, but
well,
it's a pretty strong statement. But I think one of the parts of the process that I have of sort of reasoning about like whether this was a really good move for me and my family and then and for the community at large was just to really understand that Larry Page and Ors were really committed to open source. And so that was the process, you know, before I accepted. And then to actually be inside of, you know, Googleplex now and actually be able to influence the open source strategy, it's really gone light years from, because the path before was publish a white paper and then boom, Hadoop's created in open source. And that's really cool, but now what you see is you're gonna see far less white papers from Google and you're just gonna see code, right? And I think that's, you've seen it with gRPC.
Code talks.
gRPC, Apache Beam. And what I was most intrigued about was, so it wasn't really around whether they were against open source, it was just sort of understanding what community engagement looks like, mm-hmm. like at Kubernetes. And there's a lot of opportunities. We spend a lot more time now really like, what are the areas that we should contribute? How do we create communities? And then just connecting that to, you know, strategic to us. Like, we don't really believe a proprietary cloud wins. Right, I mean, could have done that with containers. And so there's a million reasons why for end users that's just bad. And so it may be the long path, but we're taking a long path, and that's definitely open source.
And by the way, Sarah Novotny does a great job inside of Google,
awesome.
but out in the Kubernetes community. So shout out to her for her community management work. We can see that it's working. Your efforts are working.
She had a long week, and yes. So shout out to Sarah. She's fantastic. Yep.
Cool. So you know, where do you think kind of open source is heading generally? You know, it seems like it's becoming more of the go-to model for development, but where else do you see it evolving?
Well, I remember back in just dating 2002 when it was called a toy in cancer and you couldn't trust it. So I think it's awesome that we're past that. I mean, everything inside of Google's built on open source. And then even for us, we're seeing the model now where like we have a totally different tool chain inside, which is an amazing tool chain, but you're also realizing that it doesn't kind of make sense. Like it needs to converge with what the community at large is doing. And so we're looking at like, how do we really step up the contributions and build a unified community around the whole tool chain. I think one of the areas that you're seeing this evolution, like in what you saw in the past in proprietary, is you just see it's the constant competition. Look at like proprietary storage. It's constantly, there's a new company coming in, disrupting the old company again, again, and again. And open source, we're getting things behind us. It started with installers, then it went to virtual machines, and then it went to programmable infrastructure, and then it went to containers, then it went to orchestration. And nobody's really competing at those layers anymore. They're building on the layers. And I think the piece for me that I think that we really got to get to is getting from containers to services. And that has to be done in open source. Like how do you actually, like you just showed like another cool but bespoke way of deploying Cinder.
Yes.
But like we all should agree on like what that metadata model is for describing a service and then managing the control plane for that service. And it needs to run everywhere. It needs to run on Amazon, it needs to run on OpenStack, it needs to run anywhere.
Okay, so I think what you're saying is it's one thing to compose by just kind of bringing together all these different projects and services and installing them, but we don't really have a standard way of doing that. So describing the composable infrastructure in a well, sort of a language or a code-like way that's repeatable is kind of maybe the next.
Sure, that a proprietary ISV could use as well, to be honest.
Sure.
Because the myriad of ways of doing it. And the only way you're going to solve that is for all the disparate communities right, to really get together and to rally around that OpenStack and Kubernetes and Cloud Foundry and, you know, et cetera.
Well, count us in.
Good.
If there's a meeting, you know, I'll get all these people to come and it'll be good.
Sounds good.
Need a big
I'll get a lot done with.
Okay, so last area that I just am fascinated by, I know a lot of people are following this kind of machine learning thing. Google's code actually beat the Go champion, which is, you know, pretty impressive, and I think one of the things that was most exciting about that is, or scary, depending on how you look at the whole AI thing, was that the computer actually made moves that human beings had never conceived of.
Right, right.
And now we see the great players learning from the computer and saying, okay, well, wonder why it made that move. Maybe we should try that.
Yeah.
Try that. So where do you think machine learning's going?
Oh my gosh, like the I mean, 2 years ago, you didn't really hear about people talking about it so much, but AI has been going on for
50 years.
Yeah, right. And so I think that's because now, and I think that's because it's gone from a research effort to really solving business problems. And most of what probably a lot of people in this room do is we work on technology and infrastructure. But machine learning is the first time that I've seen that you can so concisely attach technology to solving a business problem.
Mm-hmm.
And so, because the technology's arrived. And so as an example, like the when you think about, you know, diabetes, it's one of the leading causes of blindness, growing causes of blindness. And so what we've done with machine learning and TensorFlow has been to actually detect that early, because it's easy when you have great ophthalmologists, but, you know, 500 million people around the world don't have that. And so to actually be able to use machine learning to actually be able to detect that early, because it's totally curable, right? So when you start, like, that's obvious. Like, somebody's like, well, that's a problem I want to solve, or cancer, or fraud detection if you're a bank. There's some really interesting business problems that are all being solved already with machine learning. And I think that's the fascinating part, is connecting that thread from problem to technology and powered by open source. Like, I mean, how cool is the fact that the heart of the framework, I mean, it's basically the Kubernetes of machine learning is TensorFlow. The heart of the framework for challenging this, I mean, really valuable, and it's happening in open source.
Well, thank you for everything you've done inside of Google. I feel like we are all benefiting from Google becoming more and more open source all the time. I mean, I use Android and Chrome and all these consumer technologies, but with Kubernetes and TensorFlow, we can see the big impact you're having in internally to make Google into another great open source source of inspiration and code, not just white papers. So thank you so much for joining us, Ryan.
Cheers, thank you.